do, I'd love to introduce Mikyung Kim to you guys. So she is the founder of M. Kim & Co. I met Mikyung 6 months ago, maybe, at Creative Mornings. So she was a regular attendee, and we got a coffee one day, and she told me that, you know, she does video production. I checked her website. I was like, wow, she's doing really amazing things. We have to get her on. And finally, we've got a theme that's just right for her. So please welcome Mikyung.
Thank you, Diana. Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming to Creative Mornings today. I'm Mikyung Kim. I'm the producer and founder of M. Kim & Co. We are a specialty team of producers that partner with creative agencies and brands to produce their TV commercial campaigns and online content campaigns too. So I started my career in Hollywood working with directors Michelle Gondry and Alejandro Gonzalez-Nerman too. I am the former head of TV at Ogilvy Hong Kong, and I've produced campaigns for global brands including SK-II, Toyota, and Samsung. My latest work also includes the 40th anniversary campaign for the Hong Kong Ballet. And as a producer, I'm responsible for supervising and managing the full filmmaking process from start to finish, from creative development to final delivery. That also includes working with creative teams, putting the key people in place like the director, and also the more unglamorous but still very important parts of business like the budget, the legal stuff, and schedules. So what is flow? So flow is a theory from positive psychology developed by Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. It theorizes that people are happiest when they are in a state of flow. It is a state of consciousness during which people find genuine satisfaction. So to quote, while in flow, you're able to forget all about the unpleasant aspects of life because the given activity demands so much of your attention. And when you're really involved in creating something new, you don't have any attention left over to monitor how your body feels or your problems at home. You can't even feel that you're hungry or tired. There is this focus that once it becomes intense, it leads to a sense of ecstasy, a sense of clarity. And you know exactly what you want to do from one moment to the other. You get immediate feedback. And you know that what you want to do is possible to do, even though it's difficult. And a sense of time disappears. You forget yourself, and you feel you're a part of something larger. And once the conditions are present, what you're doing becomes worth doing for its own sake. So it's this intrinsic motivation cycle, too. And flow is important because both it makes the present instant more enjoyable, and because it builds self-confidence that allows us to develop skills and make significant contributions to mankind. So these are the seven steps or seven parts of how it feels to be in flow. Completely involved in what you're doing, a sense of ecstasy, great inner clarity, knowing that the activity is doable, a sense of serenity, timelessness, and intrinsic motivation. So everyone is different and will achieve flow in different ways. For me, it's through producing videos and challenges through sport. But for you, it could be dancing, reading, meditation, video games. And I realized my relationship with creativity through flow at a young age. And for you, it might be different. Flow and growing up. So that's me. I was born in Seoul, Korea, and I moved to Hong Kong when I was 2 with my family. And apart from 8 years living in the US and 3 years collectively living in Seoul, I've lived in Hong Kong my whole life. So this is my home. And I think I've been trained to be in a state of flow since I was young. And I think most people growing up in Hong Kong can probably relate to this. You're growing up and you're trained to be 100% in focus and paying attention in your studies or whatever you're doing. And you would have consequences or maybe even be punished if not. I remember when I was young and I would be in a Korean tutoring center and I wouldn't be paying attention and my Korean tutor would literally roll her fist into my forehead to wake me up. And then more traumatically, when I was about 5 or 6 years old, again, I wasn't paying attention in my Korean studies. And my mom very traumatically snapped my beloved pink Power Rangers doll in half. That's me when I was about 17 years old. Growing up, I wasn't academically gifted. I would often get out of writing papers by convincing my teachers to accept the video on the subject instead. I discovered how to achieve a state of flow from a young age, and I trained myself in it. I experienced flow when I took my first video production class in middle school. And continuing into high school, I would spend all of my free time, recess and lunch breaks, in the TV broadcast room, reviewing and editing videos. And that's when I realized that the time would slip by so quickly. Even at home, I would edit videos until the early hours of the morning, looking up at the clock and realizing it was already 3 a.m., but still feeling energized. And so I realized this was something that I was very passionate about and that I should continue further studies into college and then hopefully develop into a professional career. And thanks to this, I've been able to find satisfaction and happiness in my creative career through a combination of hard work, overcoming challenges, self-improvement, and flow. So I'd like to share one of the films I produced for Toyota in partnership with the Tokyo 2020 Olympics and Paralympics. The creative agency was ADK Global, the director was Pasha Rainbow, and this was the vision of the CCO, Chris Journey. So we worked with athletes, Olympians, Paralympians, who are championing social causes that are important to them in their community. And I think athletes are very interesting characters because of what they've had to sacrifice and overcome in their life to make it to the top of their game. It's very clear that these athletes achieve success through flow in their own lives. So this is Ann Chaya. She is a Paralympic swimmer for Thailand. And Ann Chaya used to be bullied because of her disability. But she decided to focus her efforts and attention towards building a successful career as a swimmer and championing change in her community by taking a stand against bullying. So flow matters to me because it's at the essence of producing creative work successfully. Absolute focus, attention, and sense of purpose goes into creating great work. As a producer especially, a majority of my job involves creative problem solving, motivating people, enjoying that process, and the sense of joy and fulfillment. I also believe that having flow helps to open up space in your mind and time in your life to be more creative. And collaboration is key. The creative process in video is best when you're in a team. And you need to assemble the team that's best for whatever you're looking to produce. And that is a crucial part of my role as the producer. and it takes an army of people in flow state to create a film. Flow's brought me many opportunities, and it's also helped me get through challenging situations. I mean, I got the job at Ogilvy as the head of TV when I was 26. And I shouldn't say this, but I didn't know what the hell I was doing. But with passion, hard work, smart decisions, support from an incredibly talented team of people, and of course, mistakes were made and learned from. This and being in flow all led to the success of building a strong and creative video production team at Ogilvy. I've been honored to meet and work with so many creative and brilliant people. It's taken me all around the world, from New Zealand to Prague, from Bali to Tahiti. It's also important to note that I don't think it's advisable to constantly be in a state of flow. Just like with happiness, there is sadness. So with flow, there is also the opposite, apathy that exists. So I think it's about activating flow when you need it. When you need to be productive, when you need to be creative, work towards something that will contribute towards a sense of achievement, or actions towards having a greater societal impact. And people should really try and find what gives them flow, because it gives space for creativity and innovation beyond what they may be able to see without flow. So I'd like to share with you this video for the Hong Kong Ballet that I produced. The creative agency was Design Army, and the director is Dean Alexander. And this is the vision of the CCO, Poon Lefebvre. So Poon was inspired on a previous visit to Hong Kong by all the pastel colors in the architecture. So my role as a producer was to make Poon's vision all possible. And actually, at first, we didn't think we could produce the video because of budget issues. We thought we'd just do the photography. But as we continued into creative development and pre-production, we just all felt like we had to find a way to make the video possible, no matter what. And so I think with all the key people being 100% focused and dedicated to this creative vision is really what made this production possible. It was raining, and we had very strong winds that were like knocking the lights down that day. It was quite a fun shoot. Another fun video I did was this music video for The Living Sisters. It's a LA folk pop group, and the director was Michelle Gondry. And I was the production manager for this. My boss was a producer. This was about 8 years ago now. We actually shot this on 16 millimeter film, vertical video, before vertical video was even a thing. So Michelle was already ahead of his time. When I was in high school, I remember I bought the Work of Michelle Gondry DVD at the HMV in Central, and I just fell in love with the creativity in his work. The Bjork and Daft Punk music videos, to the Smirnoff and Levi's commercials, and of course, his feature film work he was most famous for, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. So he was a big influence in my life and inspired me to do what I do now. And so it was a dream come true to work with him so early in my career. And there was definitely moments of flow in this work, completely involved in what I was doing, having great clarity about what needed to be done, the time flying by, and having intrinsic motivation. But it was a really tough job, incredibly demanding. But I survived it, and I came out tougher and smarter because of it. Flow and sports. I've also had much of my flow state training from sports. Yoga, CrossFit, dragon boating, running. I think I also have a flow face where I look a bit intense and very focused. So flow is very powerful because it can give you the ability to achieve things that you didn't think you could. In CrossFit, it's just one more rep. In running, it's just one foot in front of the other. And in dragon boating, it's just one stroke at a time. And I break it down into small micro goals because it makes the larger goal seem more achievable. And I've been training my mind to be in flow in sports and that's also helped me with my personal and professional life. The singular focus and pursuit to achieve goals, no matter what, is a soft skill that can be applied to everything. So thanks to Flow, I've completed a full marathon, hiked 100 kilometers nonstop without any sleep or trail walker, and even climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. The sense of achievement is immense. I mean, you can see it in my face from the before and after. So Flow is a pursuit of one goal, that one thing or movement at a time, and repeating it until your goal is reached. So trail walker in Hong Kong was probably the most mentally and physically challenging thing I ever did in my life. And the only way I got through it was through Flow. It also included training for several months beforehand to get into mental flow and physical shape. Walking 100 kilometers nonstop for 28 hours from Saigon to Chuen Mun without any sleep. I specifically remember walking up Tai Mo Shan where this photo was taken. And as the sun rose, I felt so energized that my pace actually quickened, and the many hours that it actually took to climb up that peak, it's the highest peak in Hong Kong, seemed to pass by in minutes. So I wondered, what's the difference between being in flow versus just being really busy? I think especially living in a city like Hong Kong, where there are so many distractions, so many things to do, people to see, lots of phone and computer screen time, can get frustrating. I think for flow, you have to have a sense of purpose and an alignment to a greater goal. You could be really busy, but if you don't really care about what you're doing or feel aligned to that goal, then is that really flow? I've produced videos or had work assignments in the past that I just really didn't care about. But I would say in those times, I was really busy, so maybe the time would go by really quickly, but I was also quite unhappy. So to me, I don't think that is flow. Flow and you. So I think everyone should care about flow, because being in a state of flow is a wonderful thing and something that everyone should discover for themselves. As a takeaway this morning, reflect on when you have felt flow in your life. Was it doing some kind of activity? Does it relate to a particular passion or joy? And how did you feel during or after it? And could you recreate that flow again? Remind yourself and realize that hard work, being challenged and focused on achieving goals, actually can feel good and can give you a sense of purpose. Break your goals down into micro steps and just tackle one thing at a time. It'll make you feel happy that you achieved that one thing today. So flow is achievable for everyone, and having flow is a choice that you can make to have a happier and creative life. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Mikyung. We're gonna open the floor to any questions.
Is there a way that you find you can sort of get yourself
I think I kind of know I kind of have to set my settings to focus, and I think everyone's a bit different. So for me, I just have to be in a quiet place, no distractions, maybe some kind of music to just so it's not deadly silent. But I think for everyone, it's a little bit different, but I find that's what works for me. And also I just have to have the willpower to focus and get it done. And sometimes it's different, environments could help. Like I've been meaning to continue, I've been adapting the screenplay for a while, and I was just like, I need to get this screenplay done. It's a passion project. And so I finally was like, okay, I've got like a couple hours of Saturday afternoon. I went to pure yoga, you know, the cafe that they have. And I sat myself down and decided to just open up the screenplay again. And the last time I had opened it up was November 8th, 2018. I was like, oh my God, a year already passed by, but I guess at least I finally restarted it. So it's just having that willpower to just do something.
Hi. I'm curious about the story about how, because you said that 26 you got a job and you had no clue what to do, but how did you get there? Like, what were the little things that made you to get there?
Well, I guess I'd already been working for, you know, a few years before that in production. So I was working in LA at, I guess, the big production companies and working with these big directors. It gave me a bit of a boost in that way. So that definitely helped. And so I'd been in production, but also in post-production side. So I really knew all aspects of filmmaking process. And then I think it was just good timing as well. You know, in advertising and agencies are building a lot of teams internally to build content because there's just so much demand for content these days. And so they were looking for someone with a strong production background rather than like an agency background. And I just happened to fit the bill. And well, in terms of the way that it happened, it was LinkedIn. A recruiter found me on LinkedIn. So keywords on LinkedIn really do help.
Thanks. Similar point, I guess, when you mentioned that you got the job at Ogilvy and really had no idea what you're doing, I think there was a bit of a laugh in the room because everyone kind of resonates a little bit with that feeling. And I think that kind of imposter syndrome thing we all deal with in different ways, but obviously they hired you and they believed in you. But I'm just curious, what would be your advice in just dealing with that in everyday situations?
For me, I mean, what worked, especially when I was starting out, was just faking it until I became it. I was really insecure and just didn't have that much confidence, felt like, yeah, imposter, like I didn't deserve the job I had or I wasn't good enough. And I think, like you said, it surprisingly, or maybe not surprisingly, is something that a lot of people can relate to. And so you just, once you realize that, like if you feel like you don't know what you're doing, well, everyone else probably feels the same way. You're all just trying to figure out the best you can together. And I think knowing that, you can feel a bit of comfort and just get on with it and make the best decisions you can. Just work hard, give a shit. My dream project. Dream client. I don't really have a dream client. I think the type of dream client I have is someone who is very collaborative, looks at you as a partner rather than like a service provider or vendor, and really values your opinion and your thoughts. And I think having those kind of open conversations is what's really important rather than just being told what to do. I think that type of relationship with brands and clients is something that I really, really value. I guess in terms of a dream project, well, I briefly mentioned my passion project that I'm very slowly developing in my free time. So I'm adapting a series of short stories that were smuggled out of North Korea into an animated film.
Is that going to be finished?
I'll tell you at the next Creative Morning how it's going.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.